We pray for blessings. We pray for peace. Comfort for family. Protection while we sleep. We pray for healing. For prosperity. We pray for your mighty hand to ease our suffering. And all the while you hear each spoken need. Yet love is way too much to give us lesser things. 'Cause what if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? What if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? What if trials of this life are your mercies in disguise? For wisdom, your voice to hear. And we cry in anger when we cannot feel you near. We doubt your goodness. We doubt your love. As if every promise from your word is not enough. Desperate plea, and long that we'd have faith to believe. 'Cause what if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? And what if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? Nights, all your mercies in disguise.
His love. love will shine brightly through me. I want to be a doorway to the truth. So when you walk beyond, you will find him. I want to stand so straight and tall that you won't notice me at all. But through my open door, he will be seen, a window to his love, a doorway to the truth, a bearer of the message he'd have me bring to you. And with each passing day, each passing year, I
was blind, but
Bishop Babel, I'm the bishop for Sister Larsen, Elaine Larsen, wonderful member of the Oakwood Ward. I'll be conducting the services today, and we'd like to welcome all of the family and friends. There's family that have come in from several different states, and it's been a great pleasure of mine to be able to see and meet many of you and to see your love and your compassion and service towards one another. It's been a great example to me, and I'm very, very honored to have known and to know your family. I'd also like to thank members of the Oakwood Ward who have so faithfully supported the family as well and provided things. We're very grateful to the Sisters of the Oakwood in particular for reaching out and being a help to the family, and we thank you very much. So we'd like to begin the services today for Sister Elaine Louise Larsen. We're going to start with an invocation by Sister Sarah Hughes, Sister of Elaine. And then following the invocation, there will be a special musical number that will be provided to us, Peace in Christ. And that will be sung by Sarah Wolfenden, a daughter, Marie Town, a niece, and Shannon Town, a niece. And they will be accompanied by Emma Knoll, a niece, on the violin. So the invocation and then musical number.
Our loving Father in heaven, we come before thee at this time in thanksgiving for this beautiful woman that has been in our lives. Elaine is a treasure and has blessed us all in so many ways. We are so grateful to have this opportunity to come together, to mourn together and grieve together, but also to celebrate who she was, to celebrate the joy and the happiness that she brought to our lives, the acceptance, compassion. We pray that as we come together at this time, that thou please bless our hearts. That as we grieve and as we accept this loss, that we may know of her sweet spirit being safe with thee, and that we may have peace and joy and security. We are so grateful for her. We are so grateful for our Savior that provides a way for us to live again. And we give thee thanks in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for that beautiful number and wonderful spirit that you brought into the room here with us. At this time now, we'd like to hear from Brother Chris Knoll. He's a brother to Elaine. And then he will be providing a life sketch. And then following his remarks, Sister Laura Town, a sister, will share some memories with us. And then following her, there will be another special musical number, All Creatures of Our God and King, sung by Jolene Schultz. So we'll go to that point.
Well, I'm honored to have the opportunity to stand here and be a part of this memory of Elaine. And she, I just hope I do a good job honoring her memory. As her little brother, you'd think I would know a lot about her. But I learned doing putting the life sketch together that there's a lot of things I didn't know about her. And she really touched a lot of people. I recognize the theme. I was talking to my wife about this, and I recognize the theme, and I hope you recognize it too. She loved family. She educated herself to be in the service of others. And that's something that everything she did, she educated herself constantly, but it was always to serve others. And I love that about my sister. So, Elaine Louise Knoll was born to Daniel Francis and Twyla Raynell Knoll August 26, 1960, and she had a big sister, Wendy. She was followed by two other sisters, Laura, who was born in 1963, and Char, who was born in 1967. And then she had a brother that maybe some of you don't know about before me. His name was Danny. And and then I was born in 1974. We were going through a lot of documents the other night, and we found her baptism certificate, or I think it was a picture of her baptism, and it had a picture of her baptism, and it was she was born on September 21st, 1968, and she was confirmed by her father, Daniel Francis Knoll, her grandfather, Chris Irish, her uncle Ray, and Uncle Marion Caldwell, all of which are with her now. She was a student and a friend. She went to Meadow Homes Elementary School in Concord. She did a lot of things there. She was very, very busy as a student. She had all kinds of certificates and awards. I'll name a couple. She had a certificate of merit for helping out in the office. She had a certificate of award as a cheerleader, which seems a little different for Elaine. I'm sure she loved it. she was a helped in the library, and she was a student aide in the classroom. So she was very busy, even at that age, serving others. She was into sports. She was in the Concord State second, or Concord State, and they took second place in basketball, Beehives basketball in 1972. She was in the Oak Grove Ward and graduated from primary in 1972. She had an award for her personal achievements goals. Her MIA, she participated in a speech for MIA. She was a runner-up for a construction of a kite flying contest, which I absolutely believe because I can remember all kinds of times flying kites with her. She went to Loma Vista Intermediate, and she was an honor student. She was in the honor roll. And she was also an athlete there. She played basketball. She was the captain of the basketball team and the captain of the volleyball team there, which that's doesn't surprise me. The first, if you know Elaine, you know she's an artist. And the first thing that I found where she got to show off her work was at Mount Diablo School District. She got a certificate for sharing her art at the district art exhibit. And that, if you knew Elaine, she you saw the drawings out there. She has so many more. And unfortunately, she left at one point too, but she was such a great artist. Again, she played basketball in 1977. And she was on the swim team. And I was told that one of her biggest regrets was that she was unable to compete because she had an ear infection, but she went to state. And or she would have gone to state to compete, so but she wasn't able to because of ear infection. But and then we found that she early on the year I was born, she started volunteering. She volunteered for the Arthritis Foundation and received an award for that. She volunteered at the Historical Museum, a number of different. I won't go through all of them, but she was a volunteer. We found a tithing certificate. Her. She went to Mount Diablo and then Ignatia Valley High School, and she graduated in 1978. She also graduated from seminary, and then she went on to Ricks College, where she got an associate in advertising design, which is interesting. She never she attempted to work for an ad campaign at one time, but decided that's not what she wanted to do. She wanted to teach. She wanted to teach art, and she did. I'll get into that in a minute, but she, yes, she teach school. everybody, all the sisters wanted to make sure that I brought this up. I don't remember, I never saw it. I'm not sure what happened, but she apparently did a comedy skit. I don't know if Everybody knows who Edith Ann is. And she did this skit in college, and she did it again in the Moon Valley Ward, and apparently it's quite a funny skit. I never saw it, but I'll have to find it at some point. And then she also went to ASU. She received, and I'm not sure how to pronounce this, Soroptimist Foundation. She received an award for that. It's a support and recognition of her efforts to enhance her career potential. She also has the Golden Key National Honor Society membership. She went to Fred Jones Positive Classroom Instruction, which some of her kids told me that they remember her using that on her quite a bit, or on them quite a bit. And that's where she actually got her Bachelor of Arts in Education. And she graduated summa cum laude at ASU, which is pretty awesome. She became a wife and a mother in 1981. She married Joseph Conway, and he had three children, Jason, Tobin, and David, and she loved them very much. She also had Josiah in 1982, Joey in 1984, Sarah in 1986, Melissa in 88, and Tiancum in 91. She later moved to Arizona in 1991 with her children. And after a while of schooling and working hard, she met a man, Lloyd Larsen, who has brought a lot of joy into this family with Elaine. They became engaged in October 2008 and married in March of 2009. I might have had that mixed up, but it is right. Sarah told me that she made sure that they waited till she came home from her mission. And they did. She became a grandmother. Her first grandchild. And it was also the first great-grandchild of the family. And she had 11 grandkids. And she was dedicated to them. She loved them, every one of them. She did so many other things, and I've just got a list here. She was a Cub Scout master for Bear and Weeblos with Lloyd. She was a teacher for many years. She taught at least 5 schools, and we tried to count it, but it was at least over 20 years as a teacher. So that was with preschool at various schools. She did Seven Habits. And she even did it over Zoom. She was teaching class over Zoom just recently for kids from home. And she was very involved in doing family history. And she came up to Utah one time, and she was excited because she got to be signed up as a daughter of the Utah Pioneers. She was very proud of that. She had a certificate of completion for Key of Liberty Mentoring Training. So she helped mentor others in leadership, which was, again, she was always serving. She participated in road shows. She participated in the Oakland Temple Pageant and dance festivals, film festivals. Something that was really interesting to me is she won the Athena Award for Women. And that's a pretty prestigious award. Not too many people win that, but it's due to their leadership and their mentoring of others. And it's something that if you look it up, it's pretty prestigious. It's really neat that she won that. I think there was 35 of them in total, and she's one of them. She participated in girls' camp and was awarded the Liahona. Her and Lloyd got to do the Mormon trek, and she was very diligent in everything she did. I mentioned she did family history, and I know a lot of people do family history. I like to work on it, but I knew that if I needed something, Elaine could help me figure out that history, family history, and she knew how to dig and find information that I couldn't find. She was a temple worker, and one of the few who knew sign language, again, serving others. I was told that there's only four of them that do sign language. I'm not sure if that's here in the state, but she always was trying to educate herself in service of others, like I said. I appreciate you guys for letting me share this sketch of Elaine. There's so many more things that I know I could have said, but she was a wonderful person, and she impacted my life significantly. And I love how Sarah said in the prayer that she was a treasure. She was a treasure. She is a treasure. And I love her so much, and I love her family, and I say this in Jesus Christ, amen.
Okay, I get to tell the sister-brother memories. We were a fun family. I'm going to start with Chris's. He's the youngest of us. And he did come last, thank goodness. If not, Heavenly Father would have had very four sorry girls on his hands. We had waited for this brother. Chris remembers a special time he had with one of the sons that Elaine was able to enjoy, Jason. And he remembers a special time where he took Jason in order to learn more about him and to get closer to him. He took him on a hike, and it ended up being on a mountain that got them kind of into some precarious situation. It wasn't real safe. And when Chris got back with Jason, he felt very, very bad and thought Elaine would be kind of upset with him. And instead, he said all Elaine did was thank him and go on and on about how wonderful it was that he spent time getting to know Jason, to making him feel a part of the family. And that's Elaine. She was always looking at the optimistic and the good side of things. One of Char's favorite memories was something Chris mentioned, was Elaine performing that Edith Ann skit where she sits on that chair as a little girl, and Elaine knew it from top to bottom. And we would laugh and laugh at her. And then she remembers one summer when her and Mac, one of the boys in the McKnight family, were in charge of driving a bunch of us cousins to Grandma and Grandpa Irish's house from our house. We lived the closest to Grandma and Grandpa. We're just like 2 miles, mile and a half away. But between us was a hill that everyone had to learn the stick shift on. And Elaine hadn't had that license very long. And luckily Mac was in the other front seat with her, and of course, it wasn't an easy car to learn on. It was a VW bus. And together, one person did the stick and one did the clutch. I'm not sure who did what, but after about 15 minutes of being at the bottom of the hill, we finally arrived at the top of the hill safely. She loved camping. Every year that was available was at girls' camp. She loved the outdoors. She was so glad to. Maybe her body wasn't glad to go on all the things outside, but she loved being outside, and she loved that Lloyd took her out. So many beautiful places in this wonderful world God gave us. She loved growing her garden It was very important to her to learn to grow the food that they could eat that would nourish their bodies. Wendy, her older sister, remembered that as young girls, their mom would always dress them alike. And when they would be asked, "Are you twins?" they would say in unison, "No, we're just sisters." She remembered how they would do plays and sing and dance in the front room, and I remembered this too, and how much fun it was having neighbors come and join them, and we just knew we were the next professional group like the Brady Bunch. She remembered that parents and grandparents would endlessly volunteer us, as if we wanted to do these things, to sing and perform in front of others. And Elaine, she was there by our side, giving us courage to do it. I have to add to one of those. We were asked, and I was, I think, only five, to sing at what was our grandfather's funeral that we really didn't know very well. And it was a Catholic funeral, and we were singing a Mormon hymn, and we had to share with them to make sure that they were okay with all the words. And I was so scared to death. And Elaine was there between me and Wendy. And we sang, I don't know how it sounded, but we sang. Before she was 20, she was hired to do the commercial artwork for a political campaign in Idaho. That was part of what Chris mentioned. She loved it, the art, but she didn't like being pushed and have to rush to do her beautiful art. She just enjoyed the process of it. I get to share what I learned from her, and not from Elaine sitting down and telling me, but from Elaine's example. Her and I got to be, this is when we were pretty immature, pretty good at giving sarcastic remarks to one another and all around us. And we were really good at it, which is not really something you want to be good at. And we were so good that when we went to girls' camp, she one time was an assistant leader, and it happened to be over my age group. And not intentionally did we try this, but we were doing so good at making these remarks that when they introduced us at the end, the girls in the group said, "You're sisters?" And we felt so horrible. At that time, we met together secretly, and we decided that we weren't going to be good at being sarcastic anymore. We wanted people to know us that we were sisters. She taught me how to learn. She was always trying to learn. How did somebody do something better for her family and others? But she encouraged me to examine myself and how much was I learning to help me and my family to do better to serve others. We also spent a very much long time together as newspaper delivering girls. We got up at 4:15 in the morning and delivered that paper every day in the dark, in curlers, in apartment buildings that stunk, that were probably not the best atmosphere to be in, but at 4 o'clock in the morning, nobody was there to bother you. But we would have so much fun in the afternoon. A long time ago, you used to go and collect for your newspaper. And there were many interesting occasions, one in which we collected, and then you only had to pay like $2.70 or 75 cents for a newspaper for a month. And one time we were in front of a man who was very yellow, and we knew he had been doing things that probably weren't legal. And he handed over $25 to us. We said, "Oh, it's not that much." He said, "Oh, that's okay. You're so cute." And he gave it to us, this big tip, and we just turned around and ran. We weren't sure what to do about him. He was a little bit scary, but another person we went to was an elderly lady. There was an area where old people in the apartments lived, and during the time period that we delivered, rent jumped from $50 a month to over $100, and this poor elderly lady, when we went to collect, she was so embarrassed that she couldn't pay us. And we kind of just froze. We really didn't know what to do. And then all of them said, "Oh, don't worry. Don't worry about it. It's okay. We'll just see you another time. Don't worry about it." And I just like, because we had to pay for it. We got home and we told our mom, and she said, "Elaine, I'm very proud of you. You did the right thing. That's exactly what you should have done." And Elaine did. She knew what to do. She always knew the right thing to do. She was always very kind and giving, and always wanting to serve. Even this last year, when she was having very difficult times, as she served her grandchildren on Zoom, she was willing to be the teacher for my daughter, sign language, on Zoom. Elaine was an example of teaching us how to love, which is what Heavenly Father wanted us to do, and to learn to become like Him. Laughing was a big part of our lives. It brought us great joy. And the picture of Elaine holding our little brother Danny is one we all cherish. And she's the winner. She got to hold him again the first time. And I'm so glad she gets to be there with our parents and him. I'm very thankful for our eternal family. I'm very thankful for the gospel and the joy that it teaches us that we can have. And I know our Father in heaven lives, and that she is there in heaven serving. And I say these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.
to hear. Alleluia, alleluia. The fire so masterful and bright that gives to man both warmth and light.
Thank you, everyone who has shared such a beautiful messages and music. We're going to turn the time over now to Tiancum Conway, one of Elaine's sons. Following the memories that he will share, I will just share a couple of words. And then we'll have another special musical number, God Be With You Till We Meet Again, sung by Johnny Huerta. And then the closing prayer will be offered by Sister Wendy Pat Nuda, one of the sisters of Elaine.
I have the pleasure today to talk about my wonderful mother. From the sibling, or from her kid perspective, and I have stories from all my siblings. Our mom was a very wonderful mother. How she raised us five kids for so many years as a single mother, I have no idea how she did it so well. Josiah had a story from one of the days, early on, she was working so many jobs while she was going through school and preparing to be a teacher. One of the jobs she had was to be a pizza delivery driver for Little Caesars. And she always talked about, when she would get home, how she smelled the pizza and she was always hungry while working. And so one day, us kids put together our money and ordered pizza, and she delivered it to our house. And so we could give her some pizza so she would have something to eat during one of her shifts. And it was a funny story that we talk about off and on, and she really enjoyed it. And she always worked really hard. I remember multiple times of her having two or three jobs to support us and to be able to take care of us. Joseph remembers a time when we lived with our grandma shortly after we moved to Arizona, that all the kids, we were given cups, little cups with flowers in them, and told to eat. And Joseph was the first one to dig in, and he realized it was Oreos and chocolate pudding in it, and it was April Fool's Day. She always tried to do stuff that was funny, and that was just one of the many times that she tried to trick us. Sarah remembers a time when she was 12. She wanted to act and be a performer. And my mom was busy and had a lot going on, but Sarah heard about this audition that she wanted to be a part of. It was for a TV show. And so she begged and begged my mom to take her. And so on my mom's birthday, my mom took her, and they waited in line for 6 hours or more. And they ended up not choosing Sarah, but it just showed the dedication my mom had of just trying to put her kids first and trying to show them her love. Melissa talked about the love of camping my mom had, and how mom would always want to go camping and to take us, and how even during the last several years, even when mom hasn't been doing the best, that my mom has gone up to Utah and taken her and her kids camping with my dad. And how Melissa's kids are learning to love to camp as well. There was many memories I had when I was trying to figure what to say. My mom's always been a rock and a strength to me, especially during my health problems I've had throughout my life. Ever since I was young, I've had health problems, and my mom's always been there, even when it's not been easy. I remember one time she was just starting a new job, and she was supposed to be at some new orientation, and I wasn't doing the best, and I had to go to the hospital, and my mom was like, "My job doesn't matter. All that matters right now is you." So she dropped what she was supposed to do for her work and took care of me. There's many examples of this. Throughout her life of service and just love to one another, and how she was always there for us kids and those around us. I'm grateful for her example to me and to my kids. She'll definitely be missed by many. She's loved by many. And this I say, amen.
Thank you very much, Deancom. Well, it's been a pleasure to be here today, brothers and sisters, and to listen to these wonderful stories about such a wonderful daughter of our Father in Heaven. I'm so grateful that I've been able to know Elaine. I had the great privilege of being one of Elaine's home teachers with Lloyd, also to visit Lloyd and Elaine, and was in their home quite a few times. And I can truly testify to you that she is a beloved daughter of our Father in Heaven, who loves him very much and loves her Savior very much. And her life exemplifies that kind of life of our Savior by the choices that she made as she lived her life. And I remember in her home, or their Lloyd's home now, all the pictures on the wall of their family and children and grandchildren. And she always had something wonderful to say about her children on a regular basis. And many times that she would go and serve them, and she would go across the country to help them with various things that were happening in their lives. And it was just very, very amazing to me what a wonderful mother she was. I would have to say that Sister Larsen is the Cub Scout queen. She and Brother Lloyd, the Cub Scout king, were amazing taking care of the youth in the Oakwood and Centennial wards. There are many young men now, boys still, that learned a lot as far as what values are and as far as what skills they would need to be able to be successful in life as little boys, as Cub Scouts. And they did a great job of teaching them. She was an amazing teacher. We had some people in our ward who were not able to do things like basic reading very well. And we had a family in our ward, a single mother who had a couple of children. And she came to me and asked if she could help that family, help that mother learn how to read. And so we set up a class. There was another lady in our ward as well that couldn't read. And we set up a class during church time in Sunday school, and she would try to teach them to read. And she was just amazing. You know, patience, faithfulness, humility, those are all words that describe Elaine, and love and concern. And amazingly, she bore many physical challenges and bore them very humbly and gracefully, and was not a complainer, at least not that I was ever aware of. And Elaine continues to be a great teacher today, even though she's not here amongst us in the mortality, she is in the spirit world. As she endured years of illness, she showed us her deep faith in Heavenly Father and His Son. And through all of this, she taught us the importance of change and how beautiful it can be, because she was a person who truly changed over her life. In the Book of Mormon, the Book of Mosiah, we read, "The Spirit of the Lord Omnipotent has wrought a mighty change in us." And I would say that that's true for Elaine, or in her heart, that she no longer has any disposition to do evil, but to do good continually. That's what mortality is all about, brothers and sisters. It's about changing and becoming something different, becoming what Heavenly Father wants us to be, which is to become like His beloved Son. And we get to learn through our experiences, our successes, our mistakes, through repentance, through offering forgiveness, and through covenants to become like Jesus Christ. What an amazing blessing that all of us have. The Savior told us, "I will give unto the faithful line upon line, precept upon precept, and I will try you and prove you herewith. And whoso layeth down his life in my cause for my name's sake shall find it again, even life eternal. Therefore, be not afraid of your enemies, for I have decreed in my heart, saith the Lord, that I will prove you in all things, whether you will abide in my covenant, even unto death, that you may be found worthy." That scripture definitely fits Elaine Larsen. So each of us has a vital need to change in this life and to come unto Christ. Just a couple more things here, and then we'll close. One of the things that Elaine taught us very well is how important it is to have great relationships with those that you love and with those that you serve, whether they be in the church or in your neighborhood or wherever. I want to now read a little quote from Elder Jeffrey Holland that says, "I want to suggest to you that in your relationship with other people, including your husband or your wife and your children, that gives you the best chance to say what you believe about Christ's atonement. Your most important beliefs are not going to be statements made in a classroom. They certainly aren't going to be statements made in a symposium. What you will say best about your understanding of the Savior's atonement, about love and repentance and forgiveness, will come in your human relationships with people who have problems, people who make mistakes, who haven't in every hour of every day done all that he or she should have done in righteousness. You know, I am describing you and me. Close quote. Elaine Larsen definitely exemplified to each of us what it means to take upon us the name of Jesus Christ and to live as he lives and has how he lived when he was on the earth. I testify to you that Elaine is now in the spirit world, going forth and serving very valiantly there as she did here amongst us. And that if we could have the veil parted a little bit, we would see her loving and reaching out and being kind to those on the other side of the veil and having a wonderful time and laughing and caring with her family over there. My testimony to you, brothers and sisters, is that Jesus Christ lives. He loves us. He is the way and the life. Our Heavenly Father and His Son have prepared all things. They love us perfectly and completely. Nothing is sweeter than when we bring them into our lives and engage in doing the things that they do. Nothing brings greater joy and fulfillment in this life than knowing that we are doing and becoming what God desires for us. I challenge all of us to solidly place our feet on the covenant path that President Nelson frequently reminds us to do, and leave them there and trot on that path faithfully as Elaine Larsen has done. And then our joy will be full and we will rejoice in the day when we can be reunited with God and His beloved Son and with Elaine on the other side of the veil. And I leave that testimony with you in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Till we meet again. By His counsels guide, uphold you. With His sheep securely fold you. God be with you till we meet again. Till we meet. Again at Jesus' feet, till we meet, God be with you till we meet again. Till we meet again, when life's perils thick confound you, put His arms unfailing round you. God be with you till we meet again. Till we meet. death's threatening wave before you. God be with you till we meet again. Till we meet, till we meet, till we meet at Jesus' feet. Till we meet, till we meet. God be with you till we meet again.
Before I say the closing prayer, I'd like to thank all of you for your love and support, and that's coming from me and my family. Our dear kind Heavenly Father, we come before you this day. We thank thee so much for sending thy Son to this earth to be an example and to pay for our sins and to be able to help us to learn and grow and be able to return to thee someday. We're so grateful to be here, to be able to celebrate our Elaine's life for the wonderful example she has set for all of us. We're thankful for her love and kindness and compassion, her strong will and courage to do the things that are right and to be such a great example to all of us. We're thankful for taking her back home, relieving of her earthly pain. We're so grateful for the reunion she has with her family, her mom and her dad, and her brother and grandparents, and many more that have passed on before us. We celebrate her life and the happiness that she touched all of us and the love and kindness that she showed to us. We're thankful for the spirit of comfort that we have felt these days. We're so grateful for being here on this earth and for the challenges that we receive and being able to grow and to grow strong and to be able to return to thee someday. We pray that we might continue to do the things of thy will and to listen to thy spirit. We're thankful for being here and being able to of thy love. We ask that we might be able to return home safely and be of good health. Heavenly Father, we pray that Elaine might know of our love for her and how much she will be missed, but that someday we'll be together again. And till we meet, we send our love to thee and to her. And this we say in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
I would like to invite the pallbearers to come forward. We could have everyone rise, please. the family, if you would like to be the chaplain now too, you're certainly welcome to do so. All right, thank you, brothers and sisters. And also for the family, there will be a luncheon, and it will be in the pavilion just here to the east and south of the building. Thank you very, very much for being here today, brothers and sisters, and for the wonderful spirit that we've been able to join together. Thank you.
You don't have cards with them?
Pardon me?
Can I get copies, pictures
Absolutely.
Of them?
Absolutely. Open it up. Let's see what it's from.
I'm trying to do pictures so that they have them and share with my brother-in-law. But I'm also trying to take pictures of the flowers so they can get it.
Having your reception.
I'm not, we're not staying. Okay. Unfortunately. My wife and son have to go to work.
Thank you.